السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
السلام.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيدنا محمد الصادق الأمين المبعوث رحمة للعالمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. First, if anyone has a question, you know, and I don't know if they arrange for the woman and for the ladies today. Okay, go ahead, Munir. Who? What? Baraka, Ayman. She said she should be one of the first people to come to Islam, but for sure she is not among these five. You know. Perhaps later she became Muslim. We have this question here written. The first question, that after the marriage of Sayyidah Khadija, did the Prophet ﷺ keep taking care of her tijara or her trading without traveling, or he used to travel to close areas, you know, and not to Syria? To be honest with you, we don't have a specific narration about this matter, you know, but what I imagine, generally speaking, it did not involve himself, you know, in these activities after the getting married to Sayyidah Khadija. And most probably, perhaps Sayyidah Khadija, she used to use another person, you know, for this matter. Is the second question, is the revelation related to Hadith al-Qudsi is similar to the revelation of the Quran? Not necessary. Yani we know for sure that the Holy Quran, all of them, they were revealed in one pattern. And Hadith al-Qudsi, we have the possibility of different patterns, you know, and this should be the expectation for it. So for Hadith al-Qudsi will not be specific, but for Quran we should be specific about it. Other questions? Yes?
When you mentioned the first five who embraced Islam, they were between the Prophet's wife, alayhi salatu wasalam, his best friend, Sayyidina Abu Bakr, his Mawla, and Sayyidina Ali. But about Sayyidina Bilal specifically, do we know about his relationship with the Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam, before the Ba'tha?
The question is, does these five persons who became the first Muslims, you know, most of them, we know their special relation with the Prophet ﷺ before the revelation. What's about Sayyidina Bilal? What's the special revelation? What's the special relation between him and the Prophet ﷺ? The answer to this, you know, I don't know. I'm not well experienced, you know, of this. But I expect, you know, of the characters of the Prophet ﷺ, that he will be accepted by these people, you know, and have some sort of connection, you know, with such persons, you know. And this is the personality of the Prophet ﷺ, it plays a significant role in making people come to Islam. Just answer this question. Do you want me to repeat what I have said about Hawamim? Even though it's going to be a repetition, but I find yani significant and unique benefit for those who are interested, but perhaps better than my talk, you know, completely, you know. Here, the Hawamim, they are seven, and I look at them as a chain. This chain starts by Surah Ghafir, okay, the first of the Hawamim, speaking about Allah subhanahu, the one who initiate the revelation. And here, speaking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, maybe from different aspects, different views, different scopes. But here, speaking about Allah, concentrating on this matter of giving benefit to the other and give revelation to the other. And that's why it's no surprise that the word Rabbil Alameen mentioned three times in three consecutive verses, you know, in this particular surah, Rabbil Alameen. And this is just go back to Fatiha and search for the meaning of رب العالمين, because for me it does match, you know, the care that Allah سبحانه وتعالى provide the humanity in particular, you know, by initiating the revelation. Then the second one speak about the relation between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the revelation itself, you know, how as a step, you know, or as a, what do you call it, you know, a step between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the revelation. Then the third surah speaks, Surah Shura, about the revelation. Then you have the next surah speaking about the relation between the revelation and the messengers who receive this revelation. Then you have the coming surah, Surah Dukhan, speaking about those who, the receivers of the revelation, namely the messengers, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then the next surah speaks about the relation between the receivers, the messengers, and the nation that they are going to accept this invitation or this call from the messenger. And the last one, Surah Al-Ahqaf, speak about the nations and their response, you know, to the revelation. And I look at it as a unique chain, you know, and I most of it is the hidden chain of the physical chain that we tend to speak about. I recite it on my sheikh, and my sheikh recited his sheikh all the way to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The second question here, there's a text about it. To best of my knowledge, there's no such a text speak about this chain, you know. I may find someday, you know. You have a question?
They were like, when they were 8-9 Muslims in the beginning, they used to pray hiddenly in the Bayt of Arqam bin Arqam, or there was a masjid by the Jamrat. Which was the first hidden place? For the worship,
it should be the Bayt al-Arqam, Dar al-Arqam, which is next to Safa. Yes. Yes.
How did Rasulullah did he pray after while doing
dawah? We answered this question, and we don't have definite narration to clarify it. But apparently, no, he did not practice this, you know, after the da'wah, because we don't have such revelation that he got himself, you know, such a narration that he got himself, you know, involved in this activity. Yes?
Quick follow-up to that, how did you provide for his household need? What was his main source of income?
I'm sorry to tell you, even nowadays you may find a person, you know, they support their house, you know, from which may be called as unusual way, okay? And here the provider is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, okay? And the way that we use, not necessarily to be always, you know, and this is the only way, you know, of getting money or earning provision from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? If you want me to be physical, you know, about it, you know, and answer it physically, Sayyidah Khadija used to be rich, you know, and she still have her activity, you know, on earning money. But I'm not answering your question by this, you know, this is just to be like an idea. Yes?
Can you tell us more about Khadija and how?
Speak more about Sayyidina Khadija?
Yeah.
Okay. And I think I spoke, you know, I explained a lot. Inshallah, if time permits, you know, if we have some left time, you know, over, we may speak again, you know. If you have anything specific, you know, or more special, you know, about her, inshallah, I'll try to tell you now. But if you want in general, you know, we may postpone it.
Sheikh, I was wondering About the 14-day suspension between...
Four zero, 40 days.
Oh, it was 4-0.
Four zero, 40 days.
Even in that, then, is there something significant why it was 40 days? Like a spiritual significance?
I may not be able to answer the question, you know, but what I know for sure, the number 40, you know, it has, it is involved, you know, in many of the messengers, you know, activities, you know, and messengers' relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The real significance, I may not be يعني, able to answer it. Other questions?
Yeah, there's a question from upstairs that there are some actions that sometimes people feel like they commit an action that prevents them from finishing or completing their salah on time. Are there actions that prevent a person from seeing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the dream?
And I know that the scholars, they said the major to matters that prohibit person of seeing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, these are the two major ones. Firstly, to be lover of this dunya. Why? Because this is completely opposite of the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam looked to this dunya. He said, "Mali walid dunya. What's with, about me and this dunya?" And my example, this dunya, like a traveler, you know, he observed a tree, he stayed out under it for a while, and then he moved and left it. And the second, this mentioned by a famous scholar, this is the first major matter that blocked seeing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the other one, again, which is related to his tradition and is completely opposite of tradition, when we have a lot of masks, you know, on our face. Not face, face, okay? And here, many of us, they smile to a person that they don't love a lot, at all, they don't love a lot, and they lie to that person, and they pretend like this, and they do this, you know, and this completely opposite of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was as described by Sayyidina Umm Salama, his wife, كَانَ سِرُّهُ وَعَلَانِيَّتُهُ سَوَاءَ. His inner and his outer is the same. And as mentioned in another hadith, وَكُنَّا نَعْرِفُ ذَلِكَ مِنْهُ. The companion around the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whenever he's happy, you know, they will figure it right away. And whenever he's sad or angry, again, they are going to figure it and know it right away. So in another word, we should try to take away the masks, you know, and the way we pretend in front of the others, you know, and try just to look at our relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Unfortunately, this has been abused even among all of us, you know, without naming anyone, you know, or any type of people, you know, but all of us, you know, we tend, with few exceptions, no doubt, we tend to pretend in different way. And that's what the Prophet ﷺ said, a time coming to my nation, that the best among them, al-mudahin. And that's mean we have gotten a lot, you know, the al-mudahin is the one who, by definition, the mudahin is the one who protect his life, his word, or his money, or whatever assets, you know, in this life by sacrificing part of his religion, which is not a good action to be done.
There's another question about the difficulty. Why, I mean, what is your opinion on why the Prophet said, why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would make the Prophet said, and wait 40 days and put him through this difficulty?
To the point where he would want to commit suicide. Why would Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what's one of the wisdoms of that? Read Surah Al-Duha and you'll find the answer, even at the beginning of it. وَالضُحَى وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا سَجَى. When you have the light and when you have the darkness. And this is the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a human in this life, okay? Most of our matters is going to go by this. Sometimes you feel yourself sharp, the other time you are too dull. okay? Sometimes you feel yourself, you know, energetic, the other one too lazy. And sometimes sleepy, sometimes you are, and you name it, you know. This is, these changes to tell us that we are not going to last, okay? And we are moving. And this is a temporal matter, you know, and this is not the thing, you know. If things, it was permanent, you know, and to last for us, you know, be sure most of us will not even think about movement to the hereafter or remember the hereafter. And this is one of the wisdom from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So read carefully Sirat al-Duha and see. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that particular surah, even some positions, some situations, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam suffered of it, you know, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala moved them out. أَلَمْ يَجِدْكَ يَتِيمًا فَآوَى, and you name it, okay? Many of those matters should be studied very well, you know, and mentioned these surahs. They have been highlighted, and this is just to tell us how good Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with us, treating us very well, and how our thoughts in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should be, and how we should behave toward the others, you know, in this regard. And that's why فَأَمَّا الْيَتِيمَ فَلَا تَقْهَرْهُ. Other questions?
A lot of people say that Surah Wad-Duha is the heart of Quran. Is it true?
I haven't heard it. Possibly, you know. I know about that hadith. The heart of the Quran is Surah Yasin.
Surah Yasin.
Yeah. That's what I mean. Okay. So I move to the second stage when the Prophet was commanded to uncover or make it public, you know, for everyone, you know, about his da'wah, his invitation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we have these two verses, you know, in the Quran. One speak about it among his family, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, members, and the other one among the human or the people that he used to live with them, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The first one we recited in Surah Al-Shu'ara, وَأَنذِرْ عَشِيرَتَكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ, and those who are closest to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and namely, as narrated in Musnad Imam Ahmad, they were Bani Hashim. Okay, عَشِيرَتَكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ, the interpretation of عَشِيرَتَكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ, which mentioned in the Quran, means Bani Hashim. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib, and I think this is a sound or authentic chain, asked Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib to slaughter a small sheep, you know, and bring small amount of milk. And he made the invitation for the people of Bani Hashim, who used to be roughly 40, okay, which some of them, you know, in these odd days, one person will eat the whole, you know, the whole meat, you know, and drink the whole milk, you know. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, by saying Bismillah, has the ability to feed all the 40s, you know, of this. And he was about to start speaking, and Abu Lahab was faster than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, this is the magic of your colleague or your person, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The magic, and he said so, which is completely false about what the amount of food which was enough, you know, for 40 persons. And after a while, the Prophet again has the same action, you know, of inviting the 40 persons, you know, of Bani Hashim, in the same way done by Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib. And he took the first step, you know, to ask to tell Bani Hashim that I have given this significant favor from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is not a favor on me, this is his favor for your people, you know, for his family, and you should be the most helpful one to me, subhanallah. At that point, none of them respond except Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib, who was the Muslim, you know, at that time. After that, they start to come to Islam one after another, you know. But in this early day, in stages, only Sayyidina Ali ibn Talib was the one who was responsible, you know, for him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The common one, this is, as I said, narrated in Musnad Imam Ahmad. The common one, you read it in the books of Sirah, and it's narrated in Bukhari and Muslim, yani in the Sahihain, by Sayyidina Abu Huraira, that when the Prophet ﷺ had the other verse in Surah Al-Hijr, فَاصْدَعْ بِمَا تُؤْمَرْ وَأَعْرِمْ عَنِ الْمُشْرِكِينَ, he stood on Safa. This is the mountain. And some of you, perhaps including myself, you know, they feel the Safa is not that high nowadays. Okay, but we have a lot of changes, you know, in the pattern of the mountains and valley because of a lot of flooding, you know. As you may know, the Holy Kaaba is the lowest point, you know, in Mecca. And that's why from these mountains, any flooding or whatever happened is going all to move now. And perhaps that's why we don't observe the Safa as a high mountain. Perhaps at the time of the Prophet ﷺ was much higher than this, you know, and he was there, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and shouting to call everyone to come to him, and all, and he, in some narration, you know, in Sahih Muslim, I think, and elsewhere, that he specifically called all families, you know, and all subdivisions, you know, of the families in of Quraysh to him. And when they came to him, he gave it to them in the warning sign, as mentioned in the other one, Anzir Ashirataka, warning, okay? And this why it was in the warning form, not in the good tiding form, because people, they tend to relax, you know, and take it easy, you know, and have their time, you know, whenever they have it in the Bishara or the good news, whereas when you have it as a warning, some may have a shaky heart, you know, they are going to go quickly, you know, and try to fulfill what has been asked to be done. He said, if I'm going to tell you that there's a horse raid, you know, against you behind this valley, are you going to believe me?
He said yes.
And this is may match what I've said yesterday about the personality and characters of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. They said, yes, we are going to believe you because we have never experienced with you any lie. And he said, إِنِّي نَذِيرٌ لَكُمْ بَيْنَ يَدَيْ عَذَابٍ شَدِيدٍ. He warned them about the severe punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he spoke about the hellfire, spoke about the hereafter, which was for many of these persons, you know, not known, not never heard about, you know, before. And when he finished his talk, again Abu Lahab, he replied by saying تَبَّا لَكَ, as mentioned, you know, and the surah تَبَّا تِذَا بِلَهِ مُتَبْ was revealed, you know, after that. So by these two ways or maneuvers, we know that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam took his task completely, you know, and tried to do the maximum, you know, the best of everything, you know, to have the largest people, you know, largest number of people, you know, come to Islam by this way. Here, the whole story changed. When the Muslims, they entered this phase, they have this challenge or this problem, you know, between them, you know, and the other people, you know, of Quraysh. And Quraysh, they start feeling that this is maybe dangerous for them. In the first phase, it was not the case. And that's why they start the torment, you know, and the to the Muslims, you know, and try to punish them, you know, and try to expose them to the hot days, you know, and put some rocks, you know, on them. Even some of them, they were killed. And the first shaheed in Islam is Sumayya, the mother of Sayyidina Ammar ibn Yasir. She was killed by Abu Jahl. Even his father, you know, was Muslim, you know, he, by one way or another, he passed away, you know, in the very early day. Yasir, the father of Ammar, again, he passed away. And when they tortured Sayyidina Ammar, subhanAllah, they tortured him to the extent that he spoke badly about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam crying, you know, because this was very bad experience for him. And the verse was revealed in Surah Al-Nahl, إِلَّا مَنْ أُكْرِهَ وَقَلْبُهُ مُطْمَأَنُّ لِلْإِيمَانِ. And whenever you have any person forced, you know, to say something which is kufr, you know, that he is going to be excused if this did not affect the real faith in his heart. And the Prophet ﷺ instructed Sayyidina Umar, if they return back, speak the same thing that you have spoken before. And he described him as Ammar is full with faith till his joints, you know, all of his joints, you know, outside, they are full with faith. Imanan ila mashashi. So here, in this second phase, you have different problem. You have this punishment, this torment, torture come from the infidels, and it took many different ways, you know, of hurting the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companion. Some of it's bodily torture, as mentioned in your handout. And this is alhamdulillah for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and those noble people, you know, of the Muslims, they were protected, you know, by their family. And we mentioned yesterday, if you remember, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had this high figure, you know, or noble family, you know, among the Quraysh. And some of his companions who had the same pattern, some of them, they got exposed, you know, to some torture towards one way or another, then it was lifted up. But those, the poor and the weak people, you know, really they had a very tough time, you know, and as we said before, some of them, they died, you know, there, and some of them, they have a lot of scars, you know, in their skin according to what happened. The other form of it was the boycotting, and this is has its significant, you know, effect on Bani Hashim and Bani Muttalib. We may come and speak about it shortly later on. And the other thing, this is hurt the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was his neighbors, you know, subhanAllah, the neighbors in Mecca of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. All of them, they were infidels, you know, and they treated him badly. And the Prophet ﷺ used to say, Ya Bani Abdi Manaf, ayyu jiwarin hada. And this is the family of Bani Abdi Manaf, and you have some of these neighbors, you know, of Bani Abdi Manaf, and they used to put the garbage, you know, at the door of the Prophet ﷺ and treat him badly in this way. And another something which may be more harmful than the physical, you know, torment, when you have it done, you know, in the non-physical matter. How do you explain it? Sometimes they will torture the person, you know, and when they have this, what do you call it, you know, the ugly, some of those, yani, running on there, like the, not turtles, the others, you know, they will call it, this is your God, he will say yes, you know. And this is for the one who is believer, you know, this may be more painful to him than to have the pain, you know, on his body, you know, when he loves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a lot, and he worships Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he has this unique relationship with Allah, and then for this silly, you know, and this ugly, you know, moving, insects or whatever, this is your God, yes, you see, it's for him, this in many occasions may be much more harmful than the original one. And for sure, this has been used for the Prophet in different way. And here, he had a contract, you know, between his two daughters, you know, and the sons of Abu Lahab, and he asked them to divorce him. And all of those, they are non-physical burden, you know, put on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who suffered for himself, for his family, and for the other of the companion who used to come to him, complain to him, show some of them will show their back, you know, or their hands, or what was done to them, you know, or the scars, or whatever, you know. And here, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, for sure, he used to encourage them a lot and give them the hope and make them confident in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that person, humankind, you know, they tend to like to have everything happen quickly, you know, which is not the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is, we find it in many of the narrations that mentioned and at that particular phase, you know. And this phase, really, it was true harm. And, you know, for those people who are secluded in it, it may sound for a while that there is no relief. And I should mention this hadith, because we may experience some of this, you know. The Prophet ﷺ said, ضحك ربكم من قنوط عباده وقرب غيره. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala laughed at that the slaves of Allah, the servants of Allah, they may be despaired. And when they reach this stage, exactly when they reach it, the decision was made from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have that change. غيره means to change. قرب غيره. It was quite close, but you sometimes you feel yourself as if you have been, you know, completely left alone, and there's no help. And this is perhaps the best significant sign that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to have the change very soon. This was experienced by the Prophet and his companion. I would rather say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Surah Yusuf, this not the last verse, the first before the last one in Surah Yusuf, about the messenger and how they experienced this with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and how the change, was the good news coming from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is about to take place, you know, in this regard. And here, this leads us to the coming stage, you know, after it, and this was significant relief for the Muslims, which is when the idea of immigration to Abyssinia came to the Prophet ﷺ, and he instructed his companion to go to Abyssinia because there's a king there who is too just, you know, and he's not going to oppress any of these people. So here was the first relief given to these people, you know. For sure, when we speak about relief, we know for sure that they were fully confident in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you speak about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even from the very early days, you know, he used to speak about yuzhirahu ala dini kulli. This is going to be manifested over ever. When in one argument with Abu Jahl, he said, "I want only one word, you know, and you are going to be to rule all Arab, and all the non-Arab, they are going to have full submission to you." And this make Abu Jahl surprised. "We'll give you 10 words. Give 10 words." He said, "Say la ilaha illallah." "Oh no, I know this." Here, this is a lesson for me and for anyone, that in many occasions we are stuck, we are limited to our physical understanding, and we don't know the value of the matter given to us. About these words that you make zikr of them, la ilaha illallah, la hawla wa la quwwata illa hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakeel, and you name it, about the Quran, about the tradition of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, about your prayer, about your fasting Ramadan. Really, we don't know the real value of them, you know. We may touch some of these points, you know, or more, but usually we tend to forget many of them. So this leads us to the third phase, which I put it roughly from year 5 to year 9, this before immigration to Medina and Munawwara. I don't know how accurate I am in this. And in this, you have the migration to Abyssinia. For sure, here, when you say migration, you have a group, you know, not that large group who initiated it when they were instructed by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then they have gradually, few after few, go to Abyssinia. Okay, and as a massive immigration, you have it twice happen. The first one, when they start immigrating there, and then, as you know, you may expect, you know, in any time, and especially in their time, they will experience some of the difficulties, you know, being, you know, strangers, you know, and not know them, you know, and there's no communication with their families, you know, or whatever. So, incorrect news, they were brought to Abyssinia that Quraysh, they became Muslim, and you expect that some of them, not all of them, some of them retain back, you know, about this news to return back to Mecca. Besides that, what happened in Mecca, which may be considered as a significant turn point, you know, of the development of the invitation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when Sayyidina Hamza ibn Abd Muttalib became Muslim, and after a short while, Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab became a Muslim. This was a significant turn point for the people, because even though they are confident in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when they have this physical support, this physical strength, you know, came to them, for sure they were too happy, you know, about it. And in one narration, Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he said, we were not able, you know, to pray surrounding the Kaaba till Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab became Muslim, and he will go and pray there and enable us, you know, to go and pray there. Yeah, this is one of the points, you know, but we have many points, you know, and even this is mentioned in Sirah, when they became Muslim, both of them, Sayyidina Hamza ibn Abd al-Muttalib and Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went with them, you know, in two queues, you know, to the Kaaba, and they made tawaf there, and they made their prayer there. This tells us how it started like a small, weak plant, you know, and start to get day by day much bigger, much more stronger. You know? And this was well known for everyone. Yani here when we say recite the Quran, لِيُظْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ. You are going to find, it didn't happen, you know, overnight, you know, to have 10,000, you know, of the people, you know, come like in an army, you know, to conquer Mecca. It did not happen overnight, yes. But in general speaking, and this is, was observed by many of them, that the way, the development, the grow of Islam, doesn't fit with the natural and physical rules that we have in this earth. And this was the main reason behind the Islam of Sayyidina Khalid ibn al-Walid. When Sayyidina Khalid ibn al-Walid wants to become Muslim, he gave this reason to Amr ibn al-As. He met with him outside Mecca. And he said, ask him, where are you going? He said, I'm going to make Islam. Why? He said, because the way the Islam manifests, you know, and grow up, means that that person is a prophet, okay? And here they felt, regardless of what we are going to do, even though it wasn't perhaps very fast and very quick, you know, grow up, you know, but it was steady in growing up and gaining more and more day after day. And that's why you find that the people of the other side, whenever they grow up, they would meet and try to discuss and try to come with a conclusion. Firstly, they met, you know, to discuss what we should tell these people, you know, when they come to Mecca. Because Mecca is not an ordinary city. It's going to have a lot of strangers coming from all directions, you know, from the Arab, and they will ask Quraysh about this person. And this perhaps a good point, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala choose Mecca to have the beginning or the initiation there, just to have the news of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam go all over the Arab Peninsula by these who make Umrah, you know, in Mecca or make Hajj. So here came the first problem: what we should tell these people if we are going to go? Everyone tells about different story or fake name or this or that, they will feel that we are not right, you know, about it. So let's have one word to be said to them, you know. Shall we tell them that he's magician or crazy or liar or this? And you know, this has been mentioned in books of Sirah, and how all of these points that I tried to highlight them yesterday, they were refuted, you know, by Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira, who was one of the high figures, you know, of the infidels, you know, and he passed away as non-Muslim, yet he was honest with himself, you know, in this point, you know. When he compared between the Prophet and the magician, there is no matching at all. Compare him with the crazy, compare him with the kahin, compare him with kazzab, and you name it. And after that, he wanted to ease up, you know, with his people. He said, perhaps the closest is to say he is a magician. Okay, this was his conclusion. And you know that in Surah Al-Muddathir, after the few first verses, it was a reply to what he has said, you know, in this meeting. Again, they have the other meeting that we spoke about it yesterday, and how they offered the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam this mention here in the item number D, how Quraysh, they offered the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to give him money or make him marry a woman or this or that, you know, and we mentioned it yesterday. We may remind you about it, you know, today. So here, as I said, and then you have the other meeting, you know, when they met, and you are familiar with it, you know, when they met and decided to kill the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this was the direct reason behind immigration, why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam immigrated from Mecca to Medina. Because they وَإِذْيَمْكُرُوا بِكَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا, this we recite in the Quran, وَإِذْيَمْكُرُوا بِكَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لِيَسْبُتُوكَ أَوْ يَقْتُلُوكَ أَوْ يُخْرِجُوكَ, to imprison you or kill you or kick you out of Mecca. This is mentioned in the Holy Quran as mentioned. So again, what I'm trying to say, all of this event, it paid the attention of the others that this is something unusual. This doesn't fit with what we are familiar with. So the direct reason of Sayyidina Hamza to become Muslim was when he was told how bad was Abu Jahl in speaking with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how he has all those bad language, you know, with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he really got angry and became Muslim, you know. And this was, subhanallah, a significant and unique turn point, you know, in Sayyidina Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib. The other point was about